Good afternoon. Can I remind colleagues of the COVID-related measures and that face covering should be worn while moving around the chamber and the wider Holyrood campus. The next item of business is Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body questions. As ever, I would invite colleagues who wish to ask a supplementary to indicate during the relevant question, and if questions could be as succinct and answers to match, if that will allow us to make more progress. Question number one, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, in light of the symbols of solidarity seen across the world, whether it will, and has the equipment necessary to, light the Scottish Parliament building in the colours of the Ukraine flag at night.
Claire Baker.
I'd like to thank John Mason for the question. The demonstrations of solidarity with the people of Ukraine across Scotland and across the rest of the UK are important, and they show that we support their struggle. But the corporate body recognises the Scottish Parliament does wish to play their part. In response to the events in Ukraine, the presiding officer instructed officials of the Parliament to fly the Ukrainian flag, and this started on Monday the 28th of February. And of course, the Parliament itself marked a debate in the chamber and showed our solidarity. Unfortunately, in response to the question, the Parliament does not have the technical infrastructure to illuminate the building at this point in time.
John Mason.
Well, I thank the member for the answer. However, I do think there might be other occasions when we wanted to make a statement by Parliament, and I think nowadays lighting up in the colours of a particular organisation or country is the expected way to do things. And the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow, for example, has that. So I would ask the corporate body if they would reconsider this and look at what the costs might be. Thank you.
Claire Baker.
I thank the member for the question. It is the case that we have had a relationship with Poppy Scotland. That's the one organisation we work closely with, and the Parliament has been illuminated. We have had then to hire in equipment, which takes... We want to make sure any displays that we do are respectful to the organisation. We're happy to go away and look at this again. There are some technical difficulties of lighting this building, just the external... construction and design of the building makes it difficult to project things onto. But we are happy to look at it. The costs previously have seemed prohibitive, but I do take on board the member's comments about the need for Parliament to show connection with certain organisations, and this is an effective way to do it.
Key question number two, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body what action it has taken to advance and support the use of the Scots language across the Scottish Parliament campus.
Christine Graham.
Thank you. I thank the member for a question. For historical, for bicultural reasons, the Scots Parliamentary Corporate Body lead policy tax 10% of the use of Scots. For historical and cultural reasons, the SPCB language policy recognises the use of Scots. We support MSPs in using Scots in a number of ways, in the Chamber, committees, with constituents, and when taking their oath or affirmation. Some examples, other ones are MSPs can use Scots in the Chamber and committees, but it's just a few words and the meaning can be readily understood, or the MSP immediately translates. This can readily be accommodated. But for more lengthy speeches, the prior agreement of the presiding officer or convener is required.
Emma Harper.
Muckle thanks to Christine Graham for the report. Our Parliament Committee reports and other works are available already by request in Gaelic and BSL or other accessible formats, which, of course, is welcome. As work has gone on to support Fáilte Yezerine lead that is greed and its yinne or three national leads, could the SPCB commit to exploring whether the executive summaries or committee reports could be published in Scots as we put a refreshed focus on Scots in our own national parliament? And if you want me to translate it in English, presiding officer, I will.
I think that's fine, Christine Graham. Do you want the translation? Are you OK?
I shall cope, I think. We'll find out. As reflected, and I thank the member for the supplementary, as reflected in our language policy, all bills, delegated legislation and their accompanying documents are in English. When an MSP or a committee considers that there are good reasons for translation into a language other than English, it can be requested through the clerks. However, I'm not clear whether this actually covers executive summaries of reports, but I will confirm this, discuss it with my colleagues and return to the member when I'm clear.
Well done. And a brief supplementary from Jackie Dunbar.
Presiding officer, would the corporate body hae a thocht to the idea that if a motion is put in the mither twang with a member or the subject, for example, the Doric, that it's flipped over so a mither twang motion is first and nae the Englishine as is practised the new?
Christine
and I
Graham.
Can translate if needed.
Well, I'm afraid at the moment they are published first in English and then in another language, but Scots, which includes the Doric, which is, there are a range of languages that come under this, because we have not just Doric, we have Lallan, Scotch, and more locals, such as Buchan, Dundonian, and Glasgow or Shetland, so it's more complicated. But the Scots, which includes the Doric, continues to be recognised by the SPCB, with a languages bill expected from the Scottish Government. We'll have to allow that political process to progress, and the SPCB will, of course, reflect any legislative or policy changes, including with the official report and the business bulletin, in its own operations.
Thank you. And as Neil Gray would confirm, it would be available in Arcadian as well. Question number three, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, how many members have been unable to establish a constituency or regional office?
Jackson Carlow.
And in English, it goes without saying that all members who are entitled to a constituency office must be able to find a route to be able to access one. Currently, four members have yet to secure an office and are still looking. Most members have secured or are in the process of securing an office and or a second office. A small number have decided not to have an office.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the member for that answer. It's my understanding that Edinburgh and Lothian MSPs, both constituency and regional, have been the last to be able to source office spaces. Now, in terms of individual members, that has also presented issues with regards to the need for additional access and additional security requirements, which the corporate body are now suggesting all MSPs take into account. Can I ask if the corporate body will investigate a potential Edinburgh waiting to allowances, and also look towards how we can utilise all our allowances, how we want to see, so we can best represent our constituents in this place?
Jackson Carlow.
Well, the corporate body actually has had some fairly extensive discussions around the whole area of office accommodation. And we recognise that there are different regions and cities within Scotland where there are variable office accommodation costs. They're not equal. And we also understand that in Edinburgh and the Lothians, there is a particular issue and those costs are particularly high. So we recognise that fact. We have tried to build into the scheme additional funding, and we are prepared to look where it can be evidenced to find reasonable premises to seek to identify the additional funding that can be allocated to assist members in this process. There actually have been no such applications so far this session. There were two such applications considered in previous sessions. But we understand the nature of the issue, and officials I know are keen to work with members who are still unable to find or who are struggling to find appropriate accommodation to identify and secure that at the earliest possible date. There's no doubt and no debate that that should be possible and that that should be an issue that is resolved.
Thank you. Question number four, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Corporate Body, Parliamentary Corporate Body, what progress has been made on reopening the Scottish Parliament creche?
Claire Baker.
Thank you. The Scottish Parliament originally established a creche to improve public access and engagement for those with young children, and later in session two, that service was extended to parliamentary pass holders. The creche did close in March 2020 due to COVID-19 restrictions, and in October 2020, due to the ongoing pandemic, the corporate body did agree to temporarily discontinue the creche contract. I am pleased to say that at a recent SPCB meeting, we have agreed that as the building reopens to the public and the easing of working from home measures are introduced, we will immediately procure a new creche contract.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I would like to thank Claire Baker for the answer. As the corporate body is aware, the Parliament has in the past celebrated provision of a high-quality creche service in this building, which allowed parents and carers to access parliamentary business and meet their MSPs more easily. In October 2020, the SPCB committed to having a new contract in place as soon as possible at the start of the new session. What steps are being taken to speed this process up, including consulting with not just members but also constituents in the interest of supporting wider engagement with the Parliament?
Claire Baker.
I'd thank Faisal Chowdhury for the supplementary. I do recognise the value of the creche. I used it myself when my daughter was preschool, and I recognise how important it is for visitors and constituents. We have consulted with pass holders within the Parliament, and I thank everybody who responded to the survey. The procurement process will take around 12 months, but anything we can do to shorten that process and get the creche open as soon as possible, we will do.
Question number 5, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Deputy Officer, to ask the Scottish Parliament Corporate Body whether it will provide an update on whether it will support MSPs to install ventilation solutions in their constituency offices with funding it with the office cost provision.
Jackson Carver.
Sadly, I'm just slightly behind, Presiding Officer. Apologies. The SPCB staff have held a drop-in session on ventilation guidance and offered a one-to-one consultation to look at each local office circumstances and provide recommendations to improve ventilation where it is needed. So far, 12 offices have been provided with recommendations and a simple specification to help them discuss ventilation with their landlord, who may well also be an appropriate route to seek to underwrite the funding of any alterations, but also, if required, to seek 2 quotes for the work. 3 offices have so far provided quotes to officials. A deadline has been set for return of quotations from local offices by the 31st of March. The SPCB will then consider whether additional support is needed for ventilation solutions in local offices or whether such costs can be met within the current office cost provision limits of the members' expenses scheme. But we would quite like to see what the scope of the particular requirement is going to be before finally deciding on that point.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Jackson Carlow for that reply, and I confirm I am one of the 3 who actually has got the quotes and sent them back in. I know that every single office will be different and every set of requirements will be different also, but can I ask the corporate body that when they are taking the decision on this at some point post the 31st of March to be as timorous as possible so that when any installations can take place and need to take place, that it can happen as quickly as possible to help protect staff and also any constituents that come into the offices?
Jackson Carlow.
Yes, I can give that assurance. I mean, we understand that there are many MSPs who have got constituency offices that are in fact shop units, and it is normally regarded as ventilation if the door can open and shut because it's a shop. Obviously, when it's being used as a constituency office, the door is not opening and closing in that way, and so we appreciate that therefore there are ventilation issues that accrue. So yes, if members who are pursuing these opportunities can ensure they've got 2 quotations, we have an idea of the scale of the demand, we will be responding as quickly as we can to facilitate the introduction of ventilation measures that are appropriate.
Thank you. Question number 6 has been withdrawn. So question number 7, Jeremy Ball.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the SPCB whether it will consider amending its policy on party identity or affiliation appearing on publications paid for by the SPCB.
Jackson Carlow.
Presiding Officer, publications funded from parliamentary resources must be factual and relate to the member's work as a parliamentarian and must not be party political in nature. As such, the SPCB's policy and members' publications and the policy on the use of the Scottish Parliament corporate identity by MSPs do not permit the use of political party logos or emblems on parliamentary funded publications. This helps to ensure that parliamentary funded publications remain non-party political in nature and are not confused in any way with party-funded political publications. However, under the policy, members can include their party affiliation in the format laid out in the policy, i.e. member of the Scottish Parliament for X constituency or Y region, followed by their party in brackets. There are no plans to review this policy at this time. This is not a dispensation which is granted to MPs, for example, and I think in order to retain public confidence and trust in what is, for many, an essential means of communication, certainly in my own case it is, in the absence of any local newspaper, the one opportunity there is to communicate with all constituents, I think if it were to be seen to be compromised in a party political way, that would undermine public confidence in it, and I think there would then be calls much more difficult to withstand for us to end the ability of MSPs to send out annual reports.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank Mr Jackson for his answer? I agree with him completely. There does seem to be some confusion. Certainly when I put my report in this time and had the name Conservative, it was taken out and was not allowed to go through by the officials within. So I was wondering whether this could be looked at again and just absolute clarity could be given. Because certainly for regional MSPs, I think I had about 40 or 50 people respond back to me saying, which political party are you? And it would be helpful for them to know whether it's coming from the seven regions. So if that could just be clarified and perhaps some information sent to regional MSPs, I would be grateful.
Jackson Carlow.
And I'll certainly take that issue back. I mean, some members are particularly canny in identifying their party political affiliation because the leaflet is bright yellow, blue or red, or green, and that kind of gives it away slightly. But notwithstanding that, it is absolutely the case that all MSPs should be able, within the context of the annual report, to identify the region or constituency they represent, followed by the party affiliation in brackets. So I don't quite know why that would not have been allowed in this instance, and certainly happy to take that experience back to officials to get some understanding as to what may have happened.
Thank you, Mr. Carlow. With apologies to those I wasn't able to call, it concludes SPCB questions, and there'll be a slight pause as the front benches change.